Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. No matter what time you're watching, today is the Sunday, December 13th service, the third Sunday of Advent from Glen Abbey United Church, and we are so glad that you have been able to join with us and watch this service as we come together as a family in Christ. So may the peace of our risen Lord be with us all. Thank you so much for your generosity, and to the Outreach Committee and Pat Thompson for hosting the food drive that took place this past Tuesday at a drive-in food drive here at the church. The good news is that a trunk full of food and almost $700 was raised for Food for Kids, and then on top of that, for Halton Women's Place, almost $800. So thank you for your generosity and doing God's work in this world. A reminder that on December 24th, our team of Rick Sands, Yvonne Choi, and myself are going to endeavor to have the Christmas Eve service out to you early, so you can start planning now, whatever time of day or evening works best for you and your family to watch it. And if you have relatives that are on the other side of the world, you'll be able to coordinate with them and watch it at the same time as we celebrate the birth of Christ. Congratulations go out as well to Bruce and Susan Francis on the birth of their latest grandchild. So congratulations to you. The first Sunday of Advent, we lit the candle of hope to remind us of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ that will get us through these days into the next times. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of peace to celebrate the peace that we feel in our hearts as we go through these seasons. And today, we light the candle of joy. And to have joy in our hearts, hope and peace are probably elements of that as well. But knowing that that joy is within us can help us through anything. And for that, we are truly grateful. And so now we're going to proclaim the joy that we have in Jesus with the singing of verse number 3, A Candle is Burning. Yvonne, please. Let us all join together in the call to worship. We lit the candle of hope to remember Christ brings hope into our lives. The candle of peace shines brightly, reminding us Jesus brings peace into our world. We have just lit the candle of joy. Christ brings joy to the world. Let us worship God. And we will be with the singing of many people's favorite Christmas carol, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Yvonne?
Sleep.
Let us all join together in the prayer confession and invocation. Caring God, December is almost halfway through. Please give us hope in place of disappointment. Please give us peace in place of COVID stress. Please give us joy in place of pressure. We need to remember what you have taught us. Please forgive us and fill us with your Holy Spirit. Let us prepare our hearts, not just our homes. Fill us with wisdom so we don't get overwhelmed. Help us to remember what it is we are really celebrating. Let us take time to be joyful in the birth of our Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The really good news of the gospel is that these are elements we can have in our lives, even though the world seems to be full of chaos. The hope to go on, the peace to get us through, the joy that this pandemic cannot erase is there for us through the good news of Jesus Christ. And that is truly good news indeed. Well, trying to get my mask on. Buford! Hey, Riptide! Buford, you seem really up this week. Oh, yeah, I'm so happy. I'm so happy. I'm full of joy. You are, Buford? Because of Christmas coming? Oh, yeah, but also, it's Jesus' birthday, and we're going to have a party. Well, that is true. We'll be having a party, maybe not with a lot of people here, but we'll be connected all around the world. There could be hundreds of people watching, or thousands, or millions. Well, I don't think quite that far, Buford, but certainly we'll be connected on Christmas Eve. So you're so happy, are you? Oh yeah, I'm so happy and joyful. I want to sing. You want to sing? I thought Marshall was the singer. Oh, I know more songs than he does. Well, you do you? All right, what do you want to sing? Well, being the Sunday of Joy, I thought I'd sing Joy to the World. That would be really nice. Let's hear you do it. Okay, are you ready? Oh, I'm ready. Jeremiah was a bullfrog, was a good friend of mine. Buford, that was a big hit, but that's not the Joy to the World we want to hear. Besides, we'll be singing the real one next week. Do you have another song? Yeah, it's not as Christmassy as the last one, but it does do with joy. Okay, go ahead. Sing away. I got the joy down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart. I got the joy down in my heart.
Where?
Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart.
Down in my heart.
Oh, I'm so happy, so very happy. I got the love of Jesus in my heart.
Wow, that was something, Buford.
Am I a better singer than Marshall?
Hey, it's not a competition, but apparently you do know more tunes than he does. Well, I hope you have a great week, and God bless you. We'll see you next week.
For sure. Bye, everybody. Have some joy. All right, well, for our praise song this week, it is a new one, and I mean very new one. It was only released in November of this year. It's called The Hope of Christmas, and it is the perfect one for these times that we are living in. So I invite you to check out the video for The Hope of Christmas by Matthew West.
Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Loving God, as we go through this unusual season, many of us are having emotions we never had before. We're used to this being a time of great expectation and preparations and looking forward to events that may not be happening this year. But yet you are still always with us. You are there to help us, and you know what we need to hear. So today, as we hear these readings of Scripture, as we sing songs, as we have quiet moments, please open up our ears and our eyes to recognize what you're trying to get through to us, and then let us take it in, ponder it in our hearts and minds, and then do something about it. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. And for our reading from the prophet Isaiah, as well as the psalm, I would like to call upon Sue Lissaman, please. Sue?
The Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 7, verses 14 through 16. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Curds and honey he shall eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child shall know to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land that you dread will be forsaken by both her kings. Today's psalm is number 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, "The Lord has done great things for them." The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the water courses in the Negev. May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy. Those who go out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, carrying their sheaves. May God add his blessing to these holy words.
And thank you, Sue, for a fine job on the readings. Our gospel lesson this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 39 through 55. And this takes place exactly after our last reading from last week, where the angel announced to Mary that she was going to be the mother of the Son of God. Let's listen for God's word as we hear what was recorded. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted her cousin Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever. Thanks be to God for these very, very holy words. Well, the past 2 weeks, my messages have been titled, Hope is on the Way and Peace is on the Way. So following that progression, today's title naturally is Joy is on the Way. But in this year of the pandemic, we might be able to believe that hope and peace are attainable for us. But joy? Really? Especially for many, this will be a year of not being able to get together with loved ones, of not greeting friends at social gatherings or attending a packed Christmas Eve service in person. Well, each year when this Sunday of Joy comes along, I very briefly think about what's the difference between joy and happiness, but then never really explore it. So this year in particular, I think we should really dig into it. Now, there are a lot of published works on this very subject, and today I'm going to share with you some of the nuggets from my research. First of all, let's look at the time element. One scholar writes, happiness may be momentary, as it is a result of short-term contentment, but joy, being related to the inner self, is long-lasting. Happiness simply pleases a person, while joy brings warmth to that person's heart and brings contentment to one's heart. Now, I am sure that you are shocked that I would ever use a football analogy, but here goes. In somewhat simplified and kind of crass terms, last Monday night, the Bills made me very happy with the way our quarterback, Josh Allen, played. So it's been an enjoyable few days, but it will quickly fade if the game tonight against the Steelers doesn't go as well. But if the Bills should ever win the Super Bowl, as a long, long-suffering fan, that joy would last for months. Well, actually, probably for years, or maybe even the rest of this life. Well, we can look as well at the source of our happiness or joy to differentiate them. Marie Hondo, the organization guru, basically she says, if an item doesn't bring you joy, get rid of it. Well, if that was the correct way of saying it, we would then be living in mostly empty houses, as inanimate objects in themselves don't bring us joy. From Psychology Today, we read a good illustration of this when the writer considers their mother. This is what she writes. The transitory things of life are happiness-based. She had a big house and lost a big house when she divorced my father. She had a big career and lost a big career when she got too old, according to our culture, to have the kind of job she had. She had diamonds, and she lost diamonds. So she entered into voluntary simplicity, where the fire of purging away stuff left a clearer picture and path to the internal life. When stuff, people, and the problems they bring fall away, there is a stillness. Only in that stillness can we ever find the joy that resides inside of us, dependent on nothing external in order to exist. During this holiday season, This is a great concept to contemplate. Her joy came from deeply held spiritual beliefs, but it also came from a place even beyond that. Joy comes when you make peace with who you are, where you are, why you are, and even who you are not with. When you need nothing more than your truth and the love of God to bring peace, then you have settled into the abiding joy that is not rocked by relationships. It's not rocked by anything. It wasn't rocked as she lay dying 4 years ago in the most peaceful arms of grace, a blissful state of quiet surrender and anticipation. Those who were witness to her death still tell me that her death brought new understanding to them about the issue of real joy. Joy in all things. Death of a dream, death of a relationship, death of a body, joy from within, stripped down and beautiful. And I think in something she wrote there especially, the words from within, they give us a defining marker. Happiness has external sources. Joy is internal. Now, we absolutely love our golden retriever, Solo, and he has been such a source of happiness and joy when, frankly, we needed them the most. The fact that he is very handsome, he's friendly and smart, well, that makes us happy. But the love he gives every time he greets us brings such warmth to our hearts, and that brings true joy within. In Romans 15, Paul wrote, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope." Something I read: we give our efforts and time to pursue happiness, and we search for it in money, pleasure, status, the affection of others, or other worldly pursuits. These satisfy shallowly for a short while, but never give us the deep joy in Christ for which we were designed. We are far too easily pleased. Jesus offers true, lasting joy, a joy that surpasses all worldly pleasures and sustains during all of life, a joy that sustains us through trials and hardships and lasts forever and ever. We find this joy in Christ by beholding by faith the beauty of God's grace and love to us in Christ. Well, we see this in our reading from Luke, where we have two expectant mothers, one very young, one very old, one who had been married to the priest Zechariah for a long time, and one who was still a virgin. Although their differences were many, we know they were related, and they were both sharing many of the same experiences. The anticipation that these two women shared, I think it went beyond that of normal expecting mothers. Elizabeth and Zechariah's son, he'll play an important role as he will become John the Baptist. But Mary was even more blessed as she was fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah 7:15 that Sue read so well for us. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and will call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. We read, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb. And after the baby jumped, Elizabeth said to Mary, "You are the most blessed of all women, and blessed is the child you will bear. Why should this great thing happen to me that my Lord's mother comes to visit me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. How happy you are to believe, the Lord's message to you will come true. What does Mary say? She says, surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. People for generations are going to revere Mary for her special place in God's plan. God reached down to this simple girl and elevated her to a place of greatness. When she says, the Mighty One has done great things for me, it demonstrates her confidence that God's promise is real. Because she's not yet the mother of the child who will be great and who will be called the Son of the Most High. But God has promised it, and she believes the promise. The author of Hebrews defines faith as the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Mary, she's a person who possesses that kind of faith, and it's that kind of faith to which God calls us. Because Mary's finding true joy in having a great purpose. George Bernard Shaw, he's masterful in wordplay and in the great plays that he wrote. I didn't know he was so philosophical. He had this comment on true joy. And this is what Shaw wrote. This is the true joy in life, being used for a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one. Being a force of nature instead of a feverish, selfish little clod of ailments and grievances, complaining that the world will not devote itself to making you happy. Well, even with all the changes in our lives, and especially this Christmas season that the pandemic has caused, if we take time to ponder, we are still incredibly blessed, and we have the resources and the abilities to do great things here, to help increase joy in the lives of others. We fulfill our higher purpose not by the actual physical or financial gifts or reaching out to contact folks, but by doing so, we provide them with the joy that someone cares. Someone cares enough about them to actually do it. We increase our joy by being the hands and feet of Christ in this world when we make someone else's life better. Now, something else I read said happiness, as we are using it here, is the positive emotional feeling or sense of well-being or joy that derives primarily from external favorable circumstances. It's the feeling one gets right after you receive the job that they really wanted, or when the car starts after the third attempt. I think we've all been there. Or when we find out about a large tax refund. Since it's rooted in positive external factors, it's temporary and fleeting. Joy, on the other hand, is the deep, soul-level happiness that is a result of beholding by faith the beauty and wonders of Christ. It is rooted in Jesus, not in external circumstances, and therefore it can't easily be displaced by external changes. Indeed, a Christian can have deep and lasting joy in the midst of life's most difficult seasons. We all have had difficult seasons in life, whether on a personal or a family basis, but we've seldom encountered a challenge like this pandemic that on a global scale has affected the entire human race. And yet, that joy has continued within us. Now, its ember may have been dimmed by the daily media reports of COVID's effects, but it's still there, just needing to be fanned back into flame to burn brightly like our candle today. Pastor Rick Warren of Saddleback is quoted as saying, "Joy is the settled assurance that God is in control of all the details of my life. The quiet confidence that ultimately everything is going to be all right. And the determined choice to praise God in every situation." I like that. I like the quiet confidence that everything is going to be all right. This is the joy that will continue to carry us through as we wait for the vaccines to be manufactured and distributed. Then the world will be able to say, as Sue read for us in Psalm 126, "When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced." One quick and simple quote I really liked is, "Happiness is smiling when the sun's out. Joy is dancing in the downpour." So you know what? Maybe I got the sermon title wrong. Joy is already within us, but more joy is on the way. Well, as a third century man, Cyprian of Carthage was anticipating death, and he penned these last words to a friend. "It's a bad world, Donatus, an incredibly bad world. But I have discovered in the midst of it a quiet and holy people who have learned a great secret. They have found a joy which is 1,000 times better than any pleasure of our sinful life. They are despised and persecuted, but they care not. They are masters of their souls. They have overcome the world. These people are the Christians, and I am one of them." And with joy in our hearts, we can say, "So are we," for which we most sincerely say, "Thanks be to God. Amen." Well, in this time of offering, I encourage you for a gift of time to just forward the service to someone you know who needs some more joy in their life. Or maybe they need hope and peace, and you can send the last couple of weeks as well. Won't cost you a dime, and it's up to them if they open the links, but you might be providing just what God needs them to hear at this very moment. And thank you to the many folks who are supporting this ministry by being on pre-authorized remittance, by sending checks to the church, or by e-transferring donations at glenabbeyunitedchurch.com. We thank you so much for this, because you care about others. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Caring, loving, joyful God, we do give you thanks today that you have enabled us, that you have richly blessed us with the resources and the abilities to be able to share your love in this world, to make other people's lives a little bit better because we're able to do this work for you. And as we say that, we think about all those places in the world where people are so in need. And we ask you to soften our hearts to be able to help them as well. They really need your loving touch. We take for granted so many things: having more than enough food, warm, solid houses, transportation that we need, medical systems, sanitation, clean water. We have it all. And yet so many places are in need. And yet we still see people joyful in those places. And that, we know, is because of you. We think today of those folks who, especially during this time with such concerns, are finding that maybe their hope isn't where it should be, that they're not experiencing joy these days, and then that way they don't have a sense of peace. And we ask you to touch their hearts, to help them, to encourage them, and to lift up all the people who surround them, who can help them get through these times. We like to claim that we're such solid, upbeat people, but yet this pandemic has taken its toll on the mental health of so many. We don't like to admit it to others when we're feeling anxious, but we know we can always come to you. So in the silence of these moments, we ask you, Lord, please hear our silent prayers. And when the time is right, we so look forward to your answer. And loving God, every day, but especially at Christmas, we thank you that you care so much about us that you would want to come into this world to break in as Jesus Christ, to give us joy and peace and hope, to show us how to live. So let us all pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, as we consider Mary and the child, one of the most beautiful Christmas carols to capture is What Child Is This? And we'll be singing it now. Yvonne, please.
Son of Mary,
Well, this morning, I would like to thank Yvonne and the choir so much for their music leadership. And the amount of time that they spend doing this is tremendous, but thank you. The results are amazing. To Rick Sands, as always, for your technical work week after week after week, thank you for doing this for us. To Sue Lissaman for your reading this morning, and to all of you for being here as a family in Christ, connected over the miles, apart but never alone. Thank you for being here, and we look forward to seeing you soon. So now we're going to sing Go Now in Peace, and then we have a special Advent postlude from the choir called Advent Prayer, and then I'll be back for the final blessing. Thank you.
So as you go out into this week, as we move through Advent, please take some time for yourself. Feel the joy of the season, the joy in your heart that lasts forever. And try to do something for someone else to increase their joy, because it will only increase yours. See you next week. God bless you all.